She had a surgery May 6th. What they did on her was a vaginoplasty, and they did all the inside and outside.
Because drugs had somewhat reduced the size of Katrina's enlarged clitoris, Dr. Glassberg decided to leave it untouched.
And the question of us cutting nerves and so forth wasn't raised, wasn't an issue, because I didn't have to do the surgery. But I still think when it's large and it's something that where the parents can't deal with it themselves, then I think it should be made smaller. And I think we still are left with a sensitive organ, even when we operated on it fairly aggressively.
But because Katrina's vagina was further back than they anticipated, the surgery took longer than expected.
And towards the end, it was very hard for me because, you know, I just wanted to hold her. I didn't see her for hours, and I was just crying. I just want to hold my baby. That's all.
At 7:10 in the evening, the baby was finally on her way to recovery.
It's been a long day, but everything went very, very well. Okay, I'm very pleased. I did not have to touch the clitoris.
Healing will take about 6 months, Dr. Glassberg explains, and a second surgery is likely when Katrina reaches puberty.
We just have to accept it and be honest with the parents that a second surgery might have to be done to make the vagina wider when the child is older.
A month after the surgery, Katrina is healing well, and Rick and Tina have no regrets.
Sometimes that would come out that maybe we should have waited, but it probably would have just occurred later, you know.
Surgery is so much better now, Dr. Glassberg says, that the horror stories of the past are only historical footnotes. Howard DeVore disagrees. When he was born with severe hypospadias, or incompletely formed genitals, the doctors could have chosen male or female. What they pressured his parents into choosing, Howard says, was unnecessary surgery.
So at 3 months of age, I had my first surgery. I was now on a course that could not be altered. I was going to have surgery after surgery after surgery, and skin graft after skin graft after skin graft forever.
And then there were the minefields of puberty.
Well, you learn pretty quick that you can't expose your genitals in a large group when you're a kid like me.
98 pounders, step up.
You learn either to be the first one in or the last one in, so that you're not in the showers or changing at the same time as any of the other kids. By high school, it was just getting to be too much, so I learned how to hyperventilate so that I passed out. And I was excused from gym class.
16 surgeries later, Howard believes the operations were not only cruel, but unnecessary.
The one thing I want more than anything in this life is to have been able to have had the genitals that I was born with, that God gave me, rather than what was taken from me at 3 months of age against my will. Nobody asked me.
Cheryl Chase and Hale Hallbecker are now lobbying Congress to stop gender assignment surgery on intersexual infants.
Doctors are actually sort of the ultimate social constructionists. They actually believe, they have a formal policy at the American Academy of Pediatrics that says any child can be turned into a girl or a boy as long as we're allowed to do surgery.
The Academy's official position states, research on children with ambiguous genitalia has shown that a person's sexual body image is largely a function of socialization, and children can be raised successfully as members of either sex if the process begins before 2 years. Dr. Glassberg is the American Academy of Pediatrics spokesperson on this issue.
Well, the American Academy of Pediatrics position on all this is a somewhat evolving one, but I think we're still going to do our surgery if we feel it is indicated.
It isn't a few vocal radicals who are saying this. It's thousands of intersex people around the world. Of the hundreds of people who I've met who are intersexed, and of probably the thousands of cases that I've reviewed, I can't find one person who is happy with their surgical result, who thinks that what was done to them by surgeons is really great and they would have done it again. Not one.
Actually, neither the activists nor the surgeons have much more than anecdotal evidence. Only recently have people on both sides of the early surgery controversy pushed for better long-term outcome studies. In the meantime, Cheryl Chase says, a big step would be to tell parents that at the moment there is no reliable scientific evidence that intersex children benefit from early childhood surgery. Activists are pushing doctors for a better explanation.
And if the doctors say, you have a beautiful, healthy child, we're not exactly certain what the sex is right now, and we're going to have to do some tests to find that out. And I know that this is probably surprising to you, and you might not have heard of this before, but I have. I've seen it many times, and I'm going to introduce you to some other parents who've been through this, and I'm going to introduce you to some adults who've been through this.
Cheryl says the doctors and parents should decide together whether to label their child a boy or a girl. The baby goes home with the agreed-upon identity, but no surgery is done.
I think that when the child is old enough to make a decision for themselves, which is probably sometime during adolescence, as long as they understand what the risks are, they should be allowed to request surgery if they want it, and also to say that they don't want surgery if they don't want it.
I sincerely believe that the vast majority of patients we've done right by.
Bye-bye, sweetie. Bye-bye.
The aims of the surgery are genuinely humanitarian, the doctors who perform them say. Sometimes, Dr. Glassberg feels, the activists don't understand that.
But there were interesting and necessary questions that were being asked that we had to respond to. And I've spent hours upon hours thinking about them.
We think of male and female as the great human divide, but intersexuals are teaching us just how narrow that divide can be. Gender, it seems, is a work in progress for all of us. As research about gender identity unfolds, the question remains, what decisions are best for the infant? We've done what we thought was best for our child, Rick and Tina say. If we've made mistakes, we'll get through them as a family.
When that time comes, if it does come, that we'll be able to get over that as well. I'll be there for her no matter what.
In the end, perhaps, it's our children themselves who must tell us who and what they are. All the time.